So good morning all, welcome to the next lecture. Today we'll be revisiting the capillary instability problem through a separate analysis called the Rayleigh's work principle. Okay. So last class we had already looked at capillary instability and found that the configuration, the cylindrical configuration of a jet is unstable for k greater than 1, stable for k greater than 1 and unstable for k less than 1. So you had seen that you get a dispersion curve with a maxima close to k equal to 0.7. So today we'll revisit the problem. We'll use something called as Rayleigh's work principle. It is a static argument to determine stability. When you do a linear stability analysis, you do something called as a dynamic analysis, wherein you find out equations governing, the variables, the pressure and whatever variables are there in the problem. You get a dynamic equation, how they are related in time, and then you solve and get that dispersion equation that we had got in the last class. So Rayleigh's work principle is a static argument wherein you look at the state that you're looking for the stability of, say the cylindrical configuration of the jet, and we disturb it, like all cases where we analyze the stability, and then we look at how the energy of the system has changed, or the amount of work has been done on the system or done by the system. So based on that, we get the criteria for stability of the system. So I'll just start with what Rayleigh's work principle states. So for Rayleigh's work principle, you first of all have a state of whose stability you are analyzing, okay? And the state is perturbed to a nearby state, okay? And you find out whether work is required to be done on the system to take it to this state, or whether the system does work and goes to that state, okay? So we determine the work done to take the system from the original state to a nearby state. Okay, now if work is required to be done on the state to take it to a nearby state, which means that it has gone to a higher energy state. So which means this was a lower energy state, and therefore this would be a stable state. Okay, and if it's the other way, wherein the system, while in this state particularly, does work and goes to a neighboring state, then since it has done work and gone to the neighboring state, it has lost energy and it has gone to a lower energy state. So this has to be a stable state compared to this. So depending on the sign of the work done, or basically the energy of the system, determines whether it is stable or unstable. So wherever it is at a lower state, energy state would be the stable state. Okay. So is that clear? So I'll just write it down. If work is done by the system to move from state 1, which I'll call this, to move to state 2, which is a nearby perturbed state, okay? So if work is done by the system, which means it has lost energy and reached here, so then state 1 will be unstable. And similarly, if work is required to be done on the system, then the vice versa is true, wherein the system would be stable. Okay, so The problem that we are looking at today would be the problem of capillary instability, wherein you have a jet of radius A. So this I would call its state 1. Okay. And what we are saying is that the total energy of the system, right now it's an inviscid jet and it is stationary, static. So it's not even moving. Like the case which we had studied in the last class, wherein we looked at a stationary thread of fluid and it was inviscid. So the total energy of the system is basically dependent on the surface area which is there of the jet. Because it is, when you have a jet and it tries to break up into drops, it's basically trying to minimize the surface area, or basically trying to minimize the surface energy of the system. So the total energy of the system is determined by the surface area which is available for the jet. Okay, so we have this as state 1, and we have the state 2, which would be a perturbed jet. So we'll right now just look at one wavelength. It is infinite in the z direction. So this is my r in the radial and z is the axial. So it's an infinite jet. So I'm just looking right now at one wavelength of the jet. Okay. So say I perturb it. So this perturbation is about a mean radius. So this thing, I'll call it as R A cap. So one thing you have to notice here is that this is R equal to A, whereas I have mentioned here to be R as A cap. That's important because of the geometry that we are looking at. It is a cylindrical jet. So when you started off with one wavelength of jet and you imposed a perturbation which was of this, you know, cosine form, the volume which is added, you know, here in the crest and the volume which is reduced in the trough are not equal because of, you know, it's a surface of revolution. You know, if it was just a planar thing wherein it was symmetric, then the thing which is added and subtracted are same. But since it's a you know, so it's a volume of revolution, the amount of volume that is getting added here is definitely more than what is being reduced by the trough of perturbation. Is that clear? It's clear? No. What I want you to see is that I initially had a jet which was of radius A, and now on this jet I am imposing a perturbation which is of a cosine nature. Okay. So what this means is that near the at this crest part, the radius has increased, and at the trough part the radius has decreased. But if you try and calculate the volume which goes to the power of r square, basically, because it's a surface of revolution, so you see that the amount of volume which has been added in the crest is more than what gets reduced in a trough. Okay, so basically when you give a perturbation of this form, you have added mass into the system. So to compensate and to equate the masses of the system, you basically would have to have an A cap, which is not same as A but less than A, you know, so that you can impose a perturbation and still conserve mass. So the basic idea of choosing A cap, which is not same as A, is to impose conservation of mass. Okay, if you keep R as A and impose a perturbation of cosine form, then the mass would never be conserved. You have to have a different A cap so that the mass remains conserved. Okay. So, like I said, the amount of work which would be required to take the system from state 1 to state 2 would be dependent on the surface area of the two states. You know, so essentially all I have to do is to calculate the surface area of the jet for this particular state and surface area of the jet for this particular state, and compare for what conditions, you know, the area would increase or decrease, and thereby the energy would increase or decrease, and therefore stability could be determined. Okay, so I'll call this form of perturbation as r a cap plus a small amplitude, which is epsilon. Okay. And this surface could be just r equal to a. Okay, so now what I would do is calculate the area, which is the curved surface area, you know, the curved surface area of the jet for this particular state and the volume of this particular state. So let's find that. So area for this particular case, the state one would be just, you know, I'm looking at the curved surface area. So it is r d theta d z, which has to be integrated. Theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. And dz goes from 0 to lambda. I'm looking at one wavelength of the jet. And r is a here. So I can just replace r by a. And I would get basically 2 pi a lambda, just direct integration. So this is the area which is there for my jet, the curved surface area. So I can say that, you know, the area per unit wavelength would be nothing but 2 pi a. Fine. Similarly, I would just calculate what my volume would be. So this is the unit volume in the spherical coordinate system. So I integrate r dr from 0 to r, which is r equal to a, and then theta from 0 to 2 pi, and z goes from 0 to lambda. Okay. This should be directly the volume of a cylinder of radius a and length lambda. So which you could easily get to be pi a square lambda. So v by lambda, or the volume per unit wavelength, would be pi a square. Is this clear? So now we do the same calculation for state 2, which is a perturbed jet. So as we know, for state 2, r is given by a cap plus epsilon cos kz. And if I am along the surface of the jet, I can, you know, name this to be, say, ds, which is, you know, along the arc length of the surface, okay, and ds, and this would be dz and dr. So if I zoom that part, I would get ds, dr, and dz. Ds should come here. Along the arc length. So ds is going along the arc length, and z is the axial direction, and r is the radial direction. So by Pythagoras theorem, I can say that, you know, ds square would be dr square plus dz square. And then dividing throughout by dz, I would get ds by dz whole square 1 plus dr by dz. Or ds by dz could be written as 1 plus dr by dz to the power half.
Dr by dz square.
Oh yeah, thanks. So this is important because while I'm calculating the area of the perturbed jet, I should be going along the arc length, you know, to get the curved surface area. So I need ds by dz so that I can integrate directly in the z if I know ds by dz. So so this is my r and this is my ds by dz. So ds by dz, you know, I can write, I can get dr by dz from the equation of r here, and then that would give me ds by dz to be 1 plus dr by dz, only this term has z in it. So it would be epsilon squared. So cos differentiation would become sine. I just substituted r in this and then got ds by dz. And if I further use my binomial approximation for this, I could get, you know, 1 plus half epsilon square k square sine square kz. So any doubts still here? So once I know ds by dz, now I can calculate my, you know, the curved surface area for the perturbed jet using A. So theta goes from 0 to 2 pi and dz, z goes from 0 to lambda because it's again one wavelength. Yeah. So now we have to replace r by that form, which is, you know, a cap plus epsilon cos kz. So that gives us 0 to 2 pi, 0 to lambda, a cap plus epsilon cos kz. And ds by dz would give me 1 plus epsilon square k square by 2 sine square kz. So I can just multiply these guys and get a cap plus epsilon cos kz. Plus a cap epsilon square k square by 2 sine square kz. Plus an order of epsilon cube term integrated in d theta dz. Is this clear? So I can directly integrate it in theta and write it as multiplied by 2 pi because none of these terms are a function of theta. So that would give me directly 2 pi multiplying it. And integrating the first term with respect to z, it's a constant. So I could directly write it as a cap times lambda. No, a cap times lambda. The first term is a constant, a cap. So integrating it in z would directly give me lambda, which are the limits lambda minus 0. The second term has cos kz in it. So if I integrate the cos term, it would become sine kz. Okay. And sine kz, if I put the limits, the bottom limit would directly give me 0 because sine 0 is 0. The top limit, if I put sine kz, when z becomes lambda, lambda is nothing but, you know, 2 pi by k. So 2 pi by k gets cancelled, kk gets cancelled, and I'll just get sine 2 pi. So even that becomes 0. So essentially, when you integrate, you'll see that, you know, and put the limits, the cos term gets cancelled. Okay. So what you'll be left with is integral of this with respect to z. And that should give you a cap epsilon square k square by 4. We can see that the integral of this would be just lambda by 2. You know, sine square could be written as, you know, 1 minus cos 2x by 2. And you'll just see that the cos part again goes to 0 because it's cos, just like this term. Only 1 by 2 would be left. And then multiplied with these constants. So you'll directly get this term. So this is the area of the perturbed jet, which is nothing but 2 pi a cap lambda plus a cap epsilon square a cap k square lambda pi by 2. So since this unperturbed was called a by lambda, I'll just call this guy a cap or something. So this is the perturbed area a cap, which you get like this. So next we calculate the volume for the perturbed jet, which is nothing but v cap integrating . So you get the volume by integrating the volume element in the three coordinates. So again, you have to replace r by a cap plus epsilon cos kz. So that would give me a cap plus epsilon cos kz whole square by 2. Replacing that here, integrating this would give me r square by 2. So that's directly r out there by 2. Integrating 2 pi and 0 to lambda. Is this clear? Like integrating r dr would give me r square by 2, and r for the perturbed jet was this a plus epsilon cos kz. So I just substituted instead of r a plus epsilon. Yeah. This r is that r. It's r here. A cap plus epsilon cos k. So again, this is, none of them is a function of theta, so you could directly integrate to get 2 pi. So you'll get pi integral 0 to lambda a cap square plus 2 epsilon cos kz plus epsilon square cos square kz. And again, the cos term should go to 0 like we had got for the area case. And cos square could be again written as, you know, 1 plus cos 2x by 2. And then you'll see that, you know, that cos 2x part again goes to 0. And then you're left with just 1 by 2 here. So I'll get pi times integrating a cap square would give me lambda. And this term would just give me epsilon square times lambda by 2. Yeah, or v cap by lambda could directly be written as pi plus non square by 2. Now, this is my perturbed volume per unit wavelength. And then what I had calculated previously for an unperturbed thing was pi a square. So the conservation of mass basically means that I have to equate both the volume, because density is the same for the liquid even when you perturb it or in the unperturbed state. So I could directly equate the volume and get a relation between, you know, how a cap should be dependent on a. Okay. Only once I get how a cap depends on a can I compare the areas, because the area here is dependent on a and the area which was calculated for the perturbed jet depends on a cap. Okay, so if you have to compare the areas, you have to get a relation between a and a cap. That comes from the conservation of mass, which is equating both the volumes because the density is same. Okay, so I have e cap here, I have v here, I just equate both of them to get a relation between a cap and a, and then substitute that in the equation for area, and then I can compare the area and get the conditions for what k would the system be unstable and for what k it would be stable. So we'll just do that. So equating v and v cap, to ensure conservation of mass, we get pi a square is equal to pi a cap square plus pi. So pi gets cancelled and then we get a cap equals a square minus epsilon square by 2. So a cap would be a square minus epsilon square by 2 to the power half, or I could just take a common out and then I could write 1 minus epsilon square by 2 a square. And then again using the binomial, you know, equation approximation, we get 1 minus epsilon square by 4 a square. So I'll just write down the a cap, my lambda that we had got was 2 pi a cap. Plus epsilon square k square a cap pi by 2. Is it clear till here? We just substitute the value of, you know, the expression for a cap that we have got into the expression for area of a perturbed jet, so that we can calculate the area in terms of a and then compare it with the area of the unperturbed jet. Okay. So what we'll now do is just substitute a cap in this expression for the perturbed area and then compare it with what the area of the unperturbed jet was, which is given by a by lambda. So doing that gives us a cap by lambda is 2 pi a cap plus epsilon square k square a cap pi by 2. So instead of a cap, I have to replace it by a minus epsilon square by 4a. Plus epsilon square k square pi by 2 into a cap, which is a minus epsilon square 4 by a. So expanding it, we get 2 pi a minus 4a squared, yeah. So it should be 4a squared here and 4a squared here, correct. So 2 pi a, and then this would give me pi by 2 a square epsilon square minus, this should give me pi epsilon square k square a by 2. Is that correct?
It's not 4a.
Okay. So 2 pi a minus, is this correct? Yeah, this looks correct, yeah. I didn't carry the a square anyway, somehow. Sorry? Yeah, I can just write it as order of epsilon. This one, yeah. Okay, so if I just write it as 2 pi a and take the epsilon square out, you know, and try to club this term together, pi comes out. Let's say what else comes out, nothing else, 2 comes out. So I'm just left with 1 by a minus plus k square a. Is that correct? Plus higher order terms. So I could just take a common, so that, you know, I get something like this. So for the time being, we just don't worry about the higher order terms. We just compare the area for the perturbed jet with the area of the unperturbed jet, which is this. And we see that, you know, 2 pi a was the only term which was there here, and we have an additional term here which comes because of the induced perturbation that we had given to the jet. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll just find what the change in area is for the two case. That is just nothing but delta a. Okay. We'll find it to be per lambda, to be a by lambda minus a cap by lambda. So that would give us 2 pi a gets cancelled. So this is 2 pi a by lambda minus 2 pi a plus epsilon square pi by 2 a into a square minus 1. Okay, which is, any doubts? So this term gets cancelled, and what we are left is nothing but epsilon square pi by 2a into 1 minus k square a square. I took the minus here, so 1 minus k square a square. Is that correct? I mean, you could take it anyway. You could have subtracted this minus this or this minus this, doesn't matter. So this is my change in area per unit wavelength. So if I try and solve for the case where delta A is 0, you know, which would be the condition wherein the perturbation that I'm giving is not changing the area. So that's like the onset of instability, you know, where, you know, on one side it's positive, on one side it's negative, and at that particular k it's 0. So that's like the point which you had got in the linear stability analysis as k going to 1 in the non-dimensional frame. So here if you put delta A to be 0, implies that, you know, my ka will be 1, because this term is non-zero. So 1 minus k square a square should be 0, which means ka should be 1. Or I'll call this a particular k, which is called the kc, or the cutoff wave number, or the critical wave number. So that kc is nothing but 1 by a. So you should see that, you know, the kc, which is 1 by a, is exactly same as what we had got through the linear stability analysis. You know, remember the linear stability analysis? You had the growth rate, which was sigma squared or sigma whatever, kc, k. You had a maxima, and then you had a cutoff, after which it was stable, below which it is unstable. So this was kc, which was 1 by a. So you get the same information by not doing any complicated, you know, linear stability analysis, just by energy arguments from Rayleigh's work principle. So this is the motivation to do a Rayleigh work principle analysis of the system. So what we'll now do is we'll look at k on either side of kc. So k greater than kc, which means if my k is greater than kc, the negative term becomes dominant, or basically my delta A would be less than 0. Yeah. So if delta A is less than 0, which means the perturbed jet has lower area. Yeah. Wait, is that clear? If my k is greater than kc, so if I put kc, which was 1 by a, is that clear? If k becomes greater than kc, kc was the thing which was making both the terms equal and getting it cancelled. If my k is greater than kc, then this term would be dominant, or I'll get my area to be negative, which is less than 0. Okay, and if k is less than kc, my delta A would be greater than 0. So what does this tell me about the stability of the jet? If the perturbed jet has lower area compared to what it was, it means it has gone to a lower state, which means the jet was gone to a lower state when I perturbed it. Yeah. Correct, yeah. It has more area because it's negative, yeah. So it has more area because this term is negative. This term is negative. So the delta is negative, which means this has more area. So if the perturbed jet has more area, which means it has gone to a higher energy system, energy state, No, so if it's gone to a higher energy state by perturbation, that means where it was stable. The previous state was stable because it was at a lower energy state. Okay, so the jet is stable. And when k is less than kc and you have delta A greater than 0, it's the reverse of what this would say. So my perturbed jet would be having lesser area and thereby energy. Therefore, jet is unstable. So this is evident from the dispersion curve also. You have positive growth rates for k less than kc. So k less than kc, the jet is unstable, therefore it has positive growth rates. Whereas for jet, for k greater than kc, you have negative growth rates, which means that, you know, the jet is stable. Yeah, that's all for the class. Yeah. Thanks. Any doubts?
A equal to 0 should give a neutral stability.
Delta A equal to 0 gives you neutral stability, yeah.
Yeah, so in that curve, I mean, from the linear stability analysis,
yeah,
A equal to 0 is also a neutral stability point. But through this, we don't see that.
Yeah, that is true. But k equal to 0 is not a, it's not a perturbation which would conserve mass in any case. You can't give a perturbation k equal to 0 and have the mass conserved.
Huh?
Yeah, sigma square, yeah. But you would get the same thing if you plot. You'd get the same form of perturbation.
If k goes to infinity, then a will go to a hat, right, anyways. That should come.
No, it would be, the jet would always be r equal to a cap plus epsilon if k goes to infinity. K goes to 0, like it's kz, right? So you would always have the r which is larger than the thing. So you can't actually conserve. So that's why k equal to 0 is not considered as a perturbation. I mean, whatever analysis, whatever values of growth rate you get, you can't actually conserve mass by that perturbation. So it's not done. Anything apart from k equal to 0 is considered fine.
In linear stability, we took the perturbation of the interface as a plus some delta, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So there we took a and not a.
That was because it was infinite, so it doesn't matter much.
Here also it should be infinite, right? Just considering lambda.
No, when you are doing an analysis per unit wavelength, I think it matters for the mass to be conserved. Whereas in that, I think the continuity equation and all those the equations which are there for conservation of mass would take care of the way the velocity perturbations change when you impose that perturbation, so that the mass remains conserved. Because you are solving for those mass conservation equation, which is the continuity equation, along with, even when you, yeah, it's a flow, and then you, yeah.